Amazing Grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. Then you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Everyone, whoever you are, wherever you are, I want to say welcome and thank you for tuning in this morning for our online service. And I just pray that today God will bless your heart, God will bless your spirit, and encourage your spirit as we gather to honor and to praise and to worship the name of Jesus Christ. Psalm 100 says, "Shout with joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before Him singing with joy. Acknowledge that the Lord is good. He made us, and we are His, and we are His people, the sheep of His pasture. Enter His gates with thanksgiving. Go into His courts with praise. Give thanks to Him and praise His name. For the Lord is good. His unfailing love continues forever, and His faithfulness continues to each generation." Indeed, the Lord is good, and His love kindness is eternal. And God is faithful from generation to generation. And that's why He deserves your praise. He deserves your glory and your worship this morning. So I invite you to stand up with me and worship our Savior, Jesus Christ. Let's worship the name above all names, the name of Jesus. Amen, everybody. Amen. So please gather together with your whole family and let's worship the name of Jesus. Amen.
One thing that I want to say, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for all you've given to me, for all the blessings that I cannot see. Thank you, Lord. Grateful heart, with a song of praise, with an outstretched arm, I will bless your name. Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord. Darkness and gave me your light. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. You took my sin and my shame. You took my sickness and healed all my pain. Song of praise, with an outstretched arm, I will bless your name.
Thank you, Lord. I just want Fill our hearts with your love, Surround.
Wow, I hope you've been blessed by this time of worship, and I hope your spirit has been blessed and encouraged through these worship songs that we had this morning. Now, in the Old Testament, believers did not come to the temple to worship without an offering to give God. Indeed, their offering were essential to their worship of God. Now, while we don't worship in the temple and we are no longer to require offer sheep or doves or grain or any other kind of things, we still regard giving a wonderful way to worship God. And in Deuteronomy chapter 14 in verse 23, the Bible says like this: bring this tithe to the designated place of worship, the place the Lord your God chooses for his name to be honored, and eat it there in his presence. This applies to your tithes of grains, new wine, olive oil, and the firstborn male of your flocks and herds. Doing this will teach you always to fear the Lord your God. Now, the purpose of giving, the purpose of tithing, is based on this verse, is to teach you always to put God first in your life. When you give the first part of your income to God, is the evidence that God holds first place into our hearts. Now, when I think of all that God has given me, I find that giving back to Him is my blessing of obligation. Not only did God breathe life into me and gave me a place to live, but God offered His Son to die on the cross for my sin. And one of the ways we can give back to God is through our finances. God doesn't require much from us to give, but one of the ways is to give back through our finances. And giving money to support God's work is a joyful opportunity to participate in God's work. We can honor God through our contributions, through our giving to the local church, for advancing the work of the kingdom in this part of the world. And the sad thing that in many churches, giving and tithing is the lowest point of the service. It's for so many churches ignored and sometimes openly resented by so many people. But the Bible teaches us very clear that God wants our giving to be a deeply meaningful expression of worship. Of worship in three dimensions, in the past, in the present, and in the future. So for the next few minutes, we're going to take time to worship, to express our worship to God through our giving, through our finances. And I encourage you to give generously, to give with a cheerful heart, because the Bible says that God loves the cheerful giver. We not give because the pastor asked you to give, but I want you to give because I want you to worship a God through giving, worship a God that blessed you in the first place. And that should be your motivation when you give to God. So on the screen is going to come up the ways that you can give this morning. So please, while you give, I want you to give as an act of worship. And I want you to pray for every penny you give in, because you give to bless the kingdom of God. Amen? So watch on the screen the ways that you can give, and give it with a cheerful heart and give with generosity, because God blessed you in the first place. Amen? Amen.
I count on one thing, the same God that never never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out. And yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Oh, yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy all my days. Oh, yes, I will. I count on one thing. The same God that never fails will not fail me. Fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out. Oh yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley.
Thank you all for participating in this act of giving, worshiping through giving, and thank you for blessing the kingdom through your finances, and may God bless you because of that. Now, the church building is closed for a while, but this doesn't mean that we stopped being the church. We stopped acting the church. We stopped being the living church. We are the church, the living souls, and Peter says that the living stones are the ones who makes up the church. Now, before the lockdown, we prayed for our leadership team to be strengthened, to expand and to be strengthened. And we started with the deacons. We're going to go on further with others, but at this point we started with the deacons, which I like to call it the ministry and operational team, and we went through the process of appointing a few people that we believe God called them to serve in this role, to serve in this office, and by God's grace. By God's grace and through this process and a lot of prayer, we appointed few more people that we believe that God called them to serve in this office. And these four people will join the existing deacons, the existing the ministry and operational team. Now at this point, we have Jenny and Samuel who are active on this role, and with the new four people that we appointed, we're going to have six people on this ministry and operational team. Four new deacons is going to be a deacons created by six people. So besides Samuel and Jenny, we have four people who responded to God's calling, and this is who they are. So you can see on the screen right now, we have Mame, we have Steve Jarvis, we have Lindy, we have Mandy. And these four people, they responded to God's calling in serving our church through their gifting and through their calling. And I would like, as a step into this new role, into this new position, I would like that we as a church, we need to pray for them, we need to support them, and we need to guide them. So for the next few minutes, I would like to stand up together with me and join me in prayer as we bring them before the Lord and pray for them, guide them, and lay our hands so their ministry, their work will be blessed by God. Yeah? So let's all stand together, and I want you to place your hands to forward as a sign of blessing towards your screens, your TV, your smartphones, your computers, your tablets, iPad, whatever you use right now. Place your hands, and I want to join me in prayer for a moment. Heavenly Father, since the time of the apostles, you have inspired the church to commission certain members to assist in a special way in the pastoral mission of Jesus Christ. Heavenly Father, I just want to ask you to bless our new ministry and operational team, that they may be humble and faith-inspired in their service. Lord, I pray that you will send your Spirit upon them as they serve your church. Give them eyes to see the need of your people. Lord, I just pray that you give them a discerning mind to know your truth. And I pray that you'll grant them grace and grant them wisdom from heaven. Make their hearts like yours, so they may love your people. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Amen. I want to say thank you to Mame, to Steve, Lindy, and Mandy for accepting this new role. And we know that our team will be strengthened by your gifting and by your calling. Amen? Amen. Now, I don't know if we have out there any dreamers, any people who likes to dream. Dream about the future. Dream about everything. I'm a person who, I'm a dreamer. I love to look into the future. And I like to imagine what God could do in us and through us. I love to look into the past, what God has done, and imagine the future, what God can do for the future. Now, here's the thing. For those who can't dream anymore, for those who stop dreaming anymore, God says, if you can dream it, I can do it. If you can't dream it, I can still do it. And that's the encouragement I have for you. So my question for you, for us this morning is, what are you dreaming for? What are your dreams? Now, last year, God gave me a word, and it says, I am making something new. Get ready. Get ready. And God said, I will not build this new on the old, but I am making everything new. And I shared this word with our elders last year, and I challenged them for taking a decisions of obedience in their lives, because when God speaks very clear, the only way you will fulfill God's will for your life is through obedience, is by obeying what God is challenging you to do. And that was the challenge for the elders. And if you remember, in autumn we went together through the book of Joshua, where we learned and challenged by God to look forward, to get ready for this new thing that God is about to do. Now, coronavirus came, and who'd have thought that in this all new, that God is about to do something new, everything new. God also using this event in the human history to fulfill his plan when he said, I will make everything new. And I kept praying about this and asking God, what is this of all this new thing you want to do? And the word that God gave me again was just, get ready. And God said, you won't step into this new land, into this new promised land, if you are not ready. And I was thinking, the best way to prepare yourself, the best way to get ready for yourself, and the most important thing is through prayer. Through prayer. And this morning I want to talk about this. Now, a friend of mine, a pastor from Germany, his name is Ben, and I asked him once, what are you working on? And he said, I'm trying together with my church to go through a 40 days of prayer, and this is based on a book that is called The Circle Makers. And immediately I looked for the book, and I purchased this book, and I started reading The Circle Maker by Mark Batterson, Praying Circles Around Your Biggest Dreams and the Greatest Fear. And I was reading through this book, and I was fascinated by this book. This is one of the best books I ever read about prayer. And I thought, we have to do the same as a church, to go together through this book, to take this book, The Circle Maker, and praying circle around your biggest dreams and your greatest fear, and apply it into our church life. Now, we won't replace the Bible with this book, but there are so many good principles in this book that I would like us to learn. And I thought first to preach a series of sermons from this book, but I don't want to spoil the power of this book by my interpretation. And it's better that if everyone would read this book. And I will make sure that through this coronavirus, this lockdown that we have, and we have plenty of time, I will make sure that you will get each one of you a copy so you can read this book. It's very important that you can read this book. Now, while I was preparing to make the sermon from this book, I tried to find if the author has any sermons regarding his book, so I couldn't find it. But while I was preparing and looking for that, I came across something powerful, and I would like every one of us to watch together this, and then I will come up in the end with a conclusion for us. So let's watch together this message from Jensen Franklin.
If you have your Bibles, I'd like for you to open them with me for a few moments to the book of Joshua chapter 6. Joshua chapter 6. Look with me in the scripture, Joshua chapter 6, verse 10. Now Joshua had commanded the people, saying, everybody read this out loud. You shall not shout or make any noise with your voice, nor shall a word proceed out of your mouth until the day I say to you, shout. Then you shall shout. This is an instruction that Joshua gave the children of Israel as they were about to conquer the first city of the promised land. Joshua was aware of the inclination then and as well as now for us to talk ourselves out of the victories that are about to unfold before us. When there is no evidence, when there is delay, when there is annoyance, when there is opposition, we have a tendency, and Joshua knew it, to talk ourselves out of the victory that God is unfolding in our life. Proverbs 18 said, "The power of death and life are in your tongue." Your words have tremendous power. When and where was it that Joshua learned this subtle lesson in life? It was when he looked back in the rearview mirror at the intersection of opportunity 40 years before, when Moses sent the 12 spies and Joshua was one of the 12, and Caleb came back and said, "We are well able to take the land." But 10 came back and with their mouths dismantled the promise of God, the victory of God that he had already planned for his people. He watched them talk the whole camp of Israel out of the victory that God wanted them to have 40 years earlier. The Bible said in Numbers 13 that they brought an evil report saying, and all the congregation lifted up their voice and said, "Would to God that we would have died in the land of Egypt." This is on the brink of the greatest victory that God wanted to give his people. Another verse said, "And the children of Israel murmured, and they said one unto another, let us return to Egypt." And he sat back 40 years before, and he watched them start talking to one another and start complaining and murmuring and saying, "We can't do it, and where's grasshoppers, and those cities are so big, and those walls are so high." And he saw that happen with his own eyes, and so he understood that for every day they talked, 40 days of talking, that God gave them a year in the wilderness. And when Joshua stood there watching Israel talk themselves out of that victory, dismantling the design of God for their life with their voice and with their conversation, he determined then and there, "Never again will I get to this place where I'm on the threshold of a victory and allow words and conversations and people's discussions to talk me out of the victory God is unfolding." So he gives this command. We're going to march 6 days around the walls of Jericho every day. On the seventh day, we're going to march 7 times. And when we do that every day, you shall not utter a word. And in case you didn't understand that, you shall not let a word proceed out of your mouth. And in case you didn't get that, you shall not talk it out of your mouth, because God is unfolding a victory and you need to be quiet. Quiet, there's a victory in progress. We're inclined, ladies and gentlemen, to talk ourselves out of victory. Victory that's unfolding in our life. Victory that God is wanting to bring to our families and our homes. But we start talking negative conversation. And Joshua said, "Never again." And I want you to hear me in this room today, and those of you listening to me all around the world and wherever you're listening to this, listen, hear me. In every life, in every need, in every problem represented in this room and wherever you're listening to me, there is a victory unfolding in your life if you're trusting in God and praying and holding on to his promises. There is a victory in our homes. There is a victory in our church. There is a victory in our lives that is unfolding. Let's not talk ourselves out of the victory. Let's not begin to murmur and whine and discouraging talk and defeated talk when we understand that victory is ours. It stopped them from possessing the promised land. And Joshua said, "It's not going to happen again. The victory is not in question. I know stuff's going on. I know prophecy's being fulfilled like crazy. I know Jesus is coming soon. But let's not just talk the bad stuff that's happening in the world. Let's talk that in the last days, God's going to pour out his spirit on all flesh." There are some inevitable victories before us if we can keep our mouth shut He said, I will build my church and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. They marched to the border of victory. And there were vineyards that were already planted and homes that were already built. And all they had to do was occupy it. 2 Kings chapter 4, the Bible said there was a woman who had a son and he died. That son was born by a prophecy that the prophet gave many years before. And now the boy has died in the field. And she takes off in her chariot to get to the prophet. And a cloud of dust comes over the horizon and the prophet sees it. And he says, that's that little widow woman. Or that's that little woman that didn't have a child. And now she's going to have a child. And she had the child. Go see if everything is well with her. And the Bible said the servant went out and he asked her, is it well with your husband? And listen to her response in 2 Kings 4:26. She said, it is well. She just kept on going, getting to the prophet. And then he ran up beside her and said, is it well with thee? Are you okay? Trying to talk her down, you know. She said, it is well. It is well. She said, shh, there's a victory in progress. And then she asked him the big question. He asked her the big question. Is it well with your son? And that's where we would have fell to pieces. But she said the same words. It is well with my child that is dead. She was saying, that old prophet gave me my boy in the beginning by the word of the Lord, and I'm not about to talk myself out of a victory that's unfolding. I'm going to get to God. I'm going to get to what he promised me, and he will bring a miracle to this situation if I won't let this guy let me talk. Sometimes if you just get into discussion with everybody about things, you'll start talking yourself out of victory. Just get a word from God and talk that back to God and pray that back to God and you'll stay in victory. The Bible said in Mark chapter 5 that there was a man by the name of Jairus. His daughter was sick, and while they were on the way to pray for her, she died. And as soon as Jesus heard those words, he said in verse 36, don't say anything. Shh. And he put the mourners out, and he put the criers out, and he got in the room and he said, quiet, please. I'm about to give a great victory to my people, and I don't need a lot of talk of unbelief. And he put them out. Suffer no man to go in with me but Peter, James, and John. And he raised that child from the dead. Because he said, I need you to not talk me out of the victory. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 6 and verse 22, he said, I must go to Jerusalem and there I will suffer and die. And Peter spoke up and said to him, no, Lord, thou speakest not the things of God. No, Lord, don't do it. And he said, get thee behind me, Satan. In other words, he was saying, you are saying what you shouldn't be saying, and you're not going to stop the victory that I'm about to release to the world. I'm going to defeat sin and sickness and Satan, and you're trying to talk me out. Peter tried to talk him out of it. No, Lord, you won't go and you won't die. I won't let it happen. He said, get behind me. Called him Satan. You know, when you start speaking words that are contrary to what God said he wanted to do in your life, you are being used by the enemy. A lot of people are experiencing a lot of things. And the Lord sent me to tell you, don't talk yourself out of the victory that's unfolding in your life. Oh, I just don't see much. Shh. Do you know what prayer is? Prayer is prophecy. When you pray, you're prophesying your future. If you pray right, it's not that you can't talk to God about your problems. You can go to him and say, God, I'm lonely. I'm really, really lonely. But Lord, I thank you that you've got a man of God for me somewhere, or a woman of God for me somewhere. And I thank you. See, you're prophesying. Prayer is prophesying to your future. God, I've really got this need. It's overwhelming. This bill is coming due. But I want to thank you that you supply all my needs. You always made a way for me. And Lord, I praise you. What are you doing? Prayer is prophesying to your future. So I read a book some time ago by a friend of mine. I know this guy. He pastors in Washington, D.C. His name is Mark Batterson. And he wrote a book called The Circle Maker. And I want to tie this all together in conclusion. And he begins his book by talking about the legend of the circle maker, which is it's taught by rabbis to this day in Jewish synagogues. Josephus documented that this occurrence actually happened, by the way. Listen to this, and I just thought I'm going to do something different, but I thought I would read it to you because I'm going to sum it all up. We're going to do something in a moment. This is a class participation sermon. And in just a moment, we're going to end by drawing some circles around some needs in people's lives. And you're going to understand what I'm talking about in just a moment. Listen to this, the legend of the circle maker. Young children danced in the downpour like it was the first rainfall they had ever seen. And it was. Parents threw back their heads and opened their mouths and caught raindrops like they were diamonds falling from the sky. It could be forever remembered as the day thunderclaps applauded the Almighty, the day puddle jumping became an act of praise, the day the legend of the circle maker was born. It was the first century BC and devastating drought threatened to destroy an entire generation, the generation before Jesus. The last of the Jewish prophets had died off nearly four centuries before. Miracles were such a distant memory that they seemed like a false memory. And God was nowhere to be heard, but there was one man, an eccentric sage, who lived outside the walls of Jerusalem who dared to pray anyway. His name was Honai, and even if people could no longer hear God, he believed that God could still hear them. When rain is plentiful, it's an afterthought. During a drought, it's the only thought. And Honai was their only hope. Famous for his ability to pray for rain, it was on this day, the day, that Honai would earn his moniker. With a 6-foot staff in his hand, Honai began to turn like a math compass. His circular movement was rhythmical and methodical, 90 degrees, 180 degrees, 270 degrees, 360 degrees. He never looked up as the crowd looked on. After what seemed to be like hours, but it was only seconds, Honai stood inside of the circle that he had drawn. Then he dropped to his knees and raised his hands to heaven, and with an authority of like the prophet Elijah who called down fire from heaven, Honai called down rain. Lord, I'm quoting now, Lord of the universe, I swear before you, before your great name, that I will not move from this circle until we have shown mercy, until you have shown mercy upon your children. The word sent a shudder down the spines of all who were within earshot that day. It wasn't just the volume of his voice, it was the authority of his tone. Like water from an artesian well, the words flowed from the depth of his soul. His prayer was resolute yet humble, confident yet meek, expectant yet unassuming. Then it happened. As his prayer ascended to the heavens, raindrops descended to the earth. An audible gasp went across the thousands of congregants who encircled Honai. Every head turned heavenward as the first raindrops parachuted from the sky, but Honai's head remained bowed. The people rejoiced over every drop, but Honai wasn't satisfied with a sprinkle. Still kneeling in the circle, Honai lifted his voice over the sounds of celebration and said, "Not for such a rain have I prayed, but for rain that will fill the cisterns and the valleys and the caverns." The sprinkle turned into such a torrential downpour that eyewitnesses said no raindrops smaller than an egg in size fell. It rained so heavy and so steadily that people fled the Temple Mount to escape a flash flood. Honai stayed and prayed inside his protracted circle. Once more, he refined his bold request. Not for such a rain have I prayed, but for the rain of your favor and blessing and graciousness. Then, like a well-proportioned sun shower on a hot and humid August afternoon, it began to rain calmly, peacefully. Every raindrop was a tangible token of God's grace. And they did not just soak in the skin, they soaked into the spirit with faith. It had been difficult to believe the day before the day. The day after the day, it was impossible not to believe. The prayer that saved a generation was deemed one of the most significant prayers in the history of Israel. The circle he drew in the sand became a sacred symbol, and the legend of Honai, the circle maker, stands forever as a testimony to the power of a single prayer to change the course of history. Why did I read that? Here's why. Because in my prayer place this week, the Lord said to me, tell the people that that's exactly what Joshua did. So what I want you to do is I want you to think, what do you want me to do? If Jesus himself walked up to you this morning and looked you face to face and said, what do you want me to do for you? What is your heart? Come on. You don't have to play games with Jesus. You may can't tell other people, but you can tell Jesus. What do you want me to do? Is it a person? Maybe it's a son. Maybe it's a daughter. Maybe it's a healing. Maybe it's a financial need. Maybe it's your business. Maybe it's a grandchild. Maybe you've got cancer. Maybe you're facing some maybe you're single and you're lonely and you want God to give you the person that he's promised you. I want you to write down the number one thing you want Jesus to do for you. Write it down right now. Just take a moment. You can cover it up if you want to. If you got peepers, you know. Write it down. Maybe it's an addiction. Maybe you'd love to never pick up a bottle again. Or maybe it's a pill or drugs or I don't know, but just write it down. Maybe it's a son. Maybe it's name the child, name the person, name the issue. What do you want me to do for you? Now, have you written it down? If you have, say yes. Now take that pen and draw a circle around that need that you've just singled out. Draw a circle around it. And I don't want you to leave that piece of paper here. I want you to put it in your Bible or put it in your wallet or put it in your purse or put it on your refrigerator or put it on your mirror, even greater. I want you to put it in your car somewhere where you'll see it or wherever you will notice it. And for the next 7 days, I want you to march around it in prayer and in praise and refuse. This is the most important part. Refuse to speak or say anything about that situation. But prayer and praise, prayer and praise. How many of you believe God can honor this? Well, I don't know about that stuff. Well, you know what? I know you don't know about that stuff, but I've been around for a while. And you know how we built this church? Stuff like this. And it sounds weird to you, and it sounds crazy to you, but maybe God likes bold prayers. Maybe God likes for people to ask the sun to stand still and an axe head to swim and the Red Sea to part. Maybe God likes bold prayers. And so, have you got it? Hold it up in the air if you've got it. How many of you got a prayer circle around it right now? And you're going to, for the next 7 days, I'm going to walk around that thing in prayer. Those walls of resistance are going to come down. Hold it up, hold it up. And before we even get into the prayer and the praise, he said, when I tell you, shout. And I am your Joshua this morning. And I don't want you to wait until the wall falls. And there are some Jerichos that will never fall until you shout. I know you're dignified. I know you're something else. I know you're educated. I know you drive a Lexus. I know this. I know that. But I'm just telling you, there are some walls. See, it's just like, do you know that there are decibels, you can put it down. There are decibels that a sound that certain people can hit. Have you ever been sitting in your house and thunder roll and your windows respond? Because sound is invisible, but there are certain decibels that can hit real matter. God knows how to transform the sound of your praise to the decibel level that will make your walls of resistance respond. So I'm here to tell you, hold it up in the air and shout now. Hallelujah. Oh, come on, shout now. Shout now like you believe he can move the mountain. He can defy the walls. He can slay the giants. Shout now. Come on, take a moment. You're going to hear my voice in prayer and in praise the next 7 days. I put them in that circle. Put that husband in that circle. Put that child in that circle. Put that financial need in that circle. Glory, 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 glory. Get up on your feet and shout a little bit. Get up on your feet and shout a little bit. I know the world says this is crazy, but it's not crazy when we hear from the Lord. And I feel the Lord breathing on this little word. And he's saying, I'm telling you that if you'll agree in prayer and make a prayer circle against that attack that's come against you, no weapon formed against you will prosper, and God is going to bless whatever you put in that circle. Hallelujah! 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 Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. What counselors couldn't do, what money couldn't do, what lawyers couldn't do, what doctors couldn't do. You put it in a prayer circle and begin to prophesy through prayer that my God can do anything, anything, anything.
Wow, 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 what a wonderful, what an inspiring message. What an inspiring message. Now, sometimes the greatest challenge that we face becomes the greatest opportunity we have to see the hand of God working in ways that we never imagined. And the greatest moments in our life are the moments that we realize that our human insufficiency with God's divine sufficiency will intersect. And praying through is all about intensity. It's not about quantity, it's about the quality. And drawing prayer circles involves more than words. Praying through doesn't just bend God's ear to us, but it touches the heart of your Heavenly Father. And so my challenge for us this morning is, when was the last time you cut off the circulations of your knee before the Lord and found yourself flat on your face before the Almighty God? When was the last time you pulled an all-nighter in prayer? There is a higher height and deeper depths in prayer, and God wants to take you there. He wants to take your place, to take you places that you never been before, in the new dimensions. If you want God to do something in your life, you can't do the same old things. It's time for you to start circling. It's time for you to bring your prayers, to bring your circumstances, to bring your needs into God's circling. It's time for you to be a legend of circle maker. It's time for you to dream big. It's time for you to when God gives you a vision, God will be the provision. God makes the provision. So it's time for you to pray hard. It's time for you to have some, to have something to circle in your prayer. And because of that, God will get all the glory. So as a church, I want as a church for the next 21 days to have a time of prayer, to have a time where we can make circles around prayers, circle around people, circles around situations, circles around needs, circles around families, circles around this nation, circle around everybody that you know. I want to have this, to start this 21, this chain of prayers for 21 days. Each week you will receive a devotion for 7 days. For each day you have a devotion, and I want you to take that day, and I want you to participate in this. I want you to start circling your life into this devotion, into these prayers. So I want you to check tonight, the inbox for the next 7 days. This is a challenge for each one of you. And you know what? I can't check up on you if you do it or you don't do it. But I can tell you that this is the moment that God wants to challenge you for this. And let this prayer experiment, this 21 days prayer challenge, begin a new chapter into your relationship with God. Bring your promises, bring your needs into the circle. The dream or promise or a miracle that you bring, it might seem impossible, but if you keep circling, anything is possible. With each prayer, there is a small change in elevation. With each prayer, you are one step closer to the answer. So that's our challenge. That's my challenge for us as a church for the next 21 days, to have a days of prayer when we bring our needs, our miracles, our whatever your need is, to bring it and to circle it and to start praying about this. Amen? Amen. I want to say thank you for tuning in this morning again. And I just pray that, I just hope that this message was a blessing for you and a challenge for you to take a step into what God is challenging you. I want to end up this service with a song, where we can worship Jesus with a song that declares that our God is a miracle worker, is a promise keeper, is a way maker. So I want you to stand up together, and we're going to end up this service in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen.
Darkness, my God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are here, touching every heart. I worship you, I worship you. You are here, healing every heart. Oh, I worship you, Jesus, I worship you.
You're the way. His name is above. His name is above depression. His name is above loneliness. Oh, His name is above disease. His name is above cancer. His name is above every other name. That is who we are. That is who you are. Jesus. And that is who you are. Oh, I know that is who you are. Thank you.